Welcome back to Let's Code. Today we're talking about Stylist in the context of Yew applications. So when building a Yew site, you can obviously use CSS to style your applications because Yew is targeting HTML and the DOM, and that makes a lot of sense, right? Like you can use CSS to do that. That's pretty straightforward. You can write a CSS file, you can use classes, and then you can serve the CSS file just like normal. But there are also approaches that mirror the CSS and JS ecosystem from JavaScript. And Stylist specifically is one of those. So what this means is if we go into the packages and we find, so Stylist core is just, I think, the AST and the parser for CSS, because that has to happen. And then inside of the Stylist package, there will be a bunch of files. One of them will be something like manager. And manager overall, to make this a little bigger, is going to be responsible at some point for creating and maintaining style tags. So you can see the styles right here. And we've got this append function, and there's the style manager and things like that. So there are APIs inside of the browser that are meant for creating and maintaining style tags. Like these are just APIs that we have access to. So if we look at the Yew integration, so this is the example, or the Yew example, and I open up inspect element and I check the head, we should see a number of different styles here. So this is stylist global. So this is going to be like global styles in general, maybe whatever reset you wanted to include or something like that. There's going to be stylist with what looks like a hash on the right. If I can make this a little bigger, maybe. So this little hash on the right is usually the hash of the content of the rules of the classes. So stylist MXIYDQGL or whatever is going to be the hash of the rule set that we've put inside of this CSS declaration. And each of these, especially in development, each of these style tags is going to be inserted individually. And this is generally how it's done if you do like a CSS and JS approach. There are other approaches in the JavaScript ecosystem that are more static that will let you write CSS like we're about to see, and then take that CSS and pull it out into CSS files and serve those files. But that is not what this is. This specifically is CSS inside of our Rust application that will then get injected through these style tags into the head of our document and thus style our page. And that definitely comes with some trade-offs, right? Like it comes with a specific type of usage. Inserting those style tags does take some effort, so it's not going to be free. Whereas if you wrote CSS in a separate file, that is going to effectively be free for you comparatively, because you don't have to worry about actually inserting the styles into the document. That just happens when you ship the CSS file that you're going to use for your site. What you do get out of approaches like this is a little bit more modularity. You get a co-location of the styles that you're using and the code that you're using to render out your components. And this co-location provides a nice variant of encapsulation. So if you remember the style dash like hash class names that we saw, those are coming in from this CSS macro right here, where we can just write CSS rules however we want, and then those will get inserted into the document. Now, CSS strings, in my experience, is not the best or most composable way to write your CSS in JS. If you use objects, or in our case, it would probably be something like structs, you get a little bit more composability out of it. So you can do things pretty easily, like change different values or take multiple objects and merge them together. Whereas using strings to write your CSS is useful in some ways, where you can say copy in some CSS from somewhere, Stack Overflow, whatever you're, wherever you're getting your CSS from. Or writing it yourself as CSS in, say, like a code pen or something, and then copying it into your project. The authoring experience is nicer because you get to just copy paste that in, but you lose a little bit in terms of the ability of the language that you're using to manipulate those CSS styles. So in JavaScript, that language is JavaScript and JavaScript objects. In Rust, that would be Rust and probably structs, or like a style struct of some kind. In this case, we're using a styled component macro to create our Yew component. So we kind of lose the functional component definition here. We have to use a different macro. So theoretically, if this had some cost at runtime, I don't know if it does, just to be clear. I'm just expanding on what I know from the JavaScript ecosystem. If this has some cost, if being a style component means it has to go check something or insert some style tag and maintain that or whatever, or create an additional set of components to render, then if we didn't have the CSS here for some reason, we would have to go back and remember to change this back to a functional component. So you don't really get composability in the way that this is set up. You don't get to say functional component and then styled on top of that. You kind of just have to use Stylist Yew integration with this style component macro. So that's sort of personal choice whether you like that or not. I think just like the strings, to be perfectly honest, it's kind of a personal choice. Each project can sort of be different in that sense. One of the things that I really like about CSS in JS or CSS in Rust or whatever approaches is that it means that we can take this whole component, this inside component, and just ship it to crates.io and then install it later. And this CSS comes with that without having to do a bunch of extra steps. So for example, in this case, our app is just a use start app with app, and then app just uses styled component, and we don't have to do anything else to get the styles inserted into the document. Whereas if we were using CSS files, we would have to then add additional instructions into the README or something like that and say, hey, go make sure you include this CSS file or that CSS file. And then we have kind of a second place to create another API, right? So if this inside component matters to us for some reason, and the way that it's placed inside of other components matters to us for some reason, then the class names that we use become another level of API in addition to the level of API that we have on our component level. And there's both the local version and a global version. So we can use whatever we want in here and it won't get, say, compiled. The class names won't get compiled to anything. Whereas using the CSS macro will generate a class name for us and try to keep it encapsulated and scoped to this div specifically. So I think similarly to the way that the HTML macro in Yew doesn't currently, as far as I know, have an auto formatter, so this macro isn't getting formatted, the CSS inside of it, the nested CSS macro also doesn't have that support. So you're not getting any editor support out of having the CSS written like this either, which is important to consider because I feel like if you write in native file languages, right? Like, so if you write CSS in a CSS file instead of in a string inside of your Rust project or in a string instead of inside of your JavaScript project, then you get the full support that everybody else has built into, say, VS Code or Vim or whatever your editor of choice is to support CSS files. And that includes color pickers and syntax highlighting and autocomplete. And you're kind of losing all of that by taking this approach at the moment. But if I change this background color white to pink and I save, then you can see that it did compile and change in the browser. So trunk serve is serving our Yew application right now. And we are fully capable of changing whatever we want inside of here. So if I wanted this to be super large in terms of padding, I could make that 150 or I could change it back and it would compile again. So we don't really have to worry about hot reload or whatever. And down at the bottom here of this example specifically, I found something really interesting, which is a test to see specifically what styles were applied. Now, usually I wouldn't say that testing like to see if the background color CSS rule was properly applied with all of the specific values would be kind of a maintainable test. Like you don't really care that much about that when you're writing web apps, I don't think. But you can do it like this, which I found super interesting because we can use start app in element and basically create this fake document that we then are rendering this app into. And of course we get the document, we can get the body. All of these are unwrapped because it's a test. So we want it to fail if it's going to fail, or we want it to panic if it's going to fail rather. We can select the IDs that we have in that content. We can get the computed styles of those IDs or of those divs or whatever we have here. And then we can get the property values of the rules on those CSS declarations, which I think is really cool. It's not really something that I would reach for very often, but it does have a specific use case. So that's CSS in Rust with Stylist and Yew. I think it's really interesting. I think that the main benefit of writing stuff like this is that you can then just cargo install some component and it just works. I think that I think that there aren't any other APIs, but I don't know that for sure. That would be more like Rust struct-like. So I think we're losing a little bit of the composability or the Rust language to create these styles. It would be a little bit more verbose to do so. And of course, HTML and CSS is kind of one of those things where, yeah, there are specs for these kinds of things, but the specs only matter insofar as the browsers do things that match the specs, and the browser runtimes are so rich and varied that we can have different behavior in different systems. So it can be hard to write something that would say be spec compliant and have it work the same way in all browsers. But that's the overview for CSS in Rust, is what I guess what we'll call it. I don't know that I'm going to choose this for my Yew applications. I do kind of like it, but I also don't have the use case of shipping a ton of components to crates.io right now. So I think one of the main advantages of writing styles like this that is left would be the co-location of the styles and the components themselves. But I think if I'm going to do that, I would prefer something that pulled it out statically in most cases. But I don't know if that exists for Yew. So styles in Yew. I guess we'll find out what else is out there. And I hope you enjoyed the video, and have a great rest of your day.